I'm at a red light, just so we're clear, so don't get mad at me for driving while doing this. I say that mostly to my wife, who got mad at me last time I was doing this. I love watching sports in VR. I love the idea of immersive sports viewing and entertainment. I think it's a great way to do it. The real challenge is just the license holders, actually. So the real key is getting the leagues to open this up as part of the rights process, and making it something that is affordable for the size of audience that we have. And better than that, just do it themselves. They could bring a tremendous amount of value. If you were a stadium owner to people, you could sell your courtside seats. You could resell the same seat to a bunch of people if you had the right rig there. I just think it's like, I think there's a tremendous opportunity there. I also think there's some really cool things that you can do once you have that experience, not only to have a game immersive, but also to have real-time stats and overlays. So there's a huge opportunity here for somebody. But you've got to have the rights holders on board. Okay, another red light. This is a funny question because it's asking me about a device that doesn't exist. So it wants to know, it weighs nothing because it doesn't exist. What do I think? The thing that I have to keep reminding people is we do tons of prototyping. We do tons of different versions internally. Those teams certainly want their device to be the next Quest, whatever thing. But it's not so until I say it is. There's no device with that name as of now. Okay, this is the no look since I'm driving. The Quest operating system today does a lot of the jobs it's asked to do very well. If you're in the browser, you're on YouTube, your panels, you're chatting with friends, you're getting into your immersive experiences, all those pieces do well. And it's clearly more capable than people even realize. If you go into workrooms, you can get your three monitors set up, that kind of thing right now. But I do think now that we have mixed reality and hands, we have kind of a much stronger sense of what the base platform is going to be, not just for this headset, but for several generations of headsets to come. They'll have their own improvements, but the platform capabilities will be the same, even if the quality of the experience goes up. So I do think there's opportunities for us that we've been exploring for a while and modeling for a while that really didn't feel right before Quest 3, but I do think are going to be right for Quest 3 and for subsequent headsets. What would that look like? Let me tell you. I don't want to give all the details away. We got to keep some surprises, some things to announce, some things to get people excited. But I'll tell you right now, a good example of this is just now that you have mixed reality, how people want to interact with panels has changed a bunch. And so you've got a really fun idea, which I think is the right idea, which is like a personal UI. The UI that you take with you everywhere you go, that's maybe even tethered to your body or to your head, in terms of as you move around. And then you also want to have stationary UI. You want to have this UI that's out in space that stays world locked wherever you've put it. We have versions of these today with the panels, but I think the fluidity of how you interact between those two things is an area of tremendous opportunity, to make things feel really comfortable and clear. I think another one is how we interact with other devices. When you think about casting and streaming, both from the device and to the device, that's an area where I think there's a lot of opportunity still ahead of us that we're focused on. I won't give up anymore. There's a lot more. Yeah, so if you look online, you will find a video of me demonstrating this example of touch typing with just a camera and a desk in front of me, but no actual keyboard. And I was able to achieve 119 words per minute, which was the record for all people who tried it until Susan Lee, our CFO, beat me by a good margin, I think. I think it was like 128 or something like that. So it can be done. It's really good. It's a general model. They had done no personalized training on me when I achieved that result. There's still a lot of work to do to miniaturize the models and have them work on just regular hardware alongside other processes that are running like Guardian. But we are on a path to exactly this. We're very excited about that. Mark Zuckerberg himself weighed in on this over the weekend. There was a discussion happening over on Threads, where somebody had kind of asserted that this was a gaming-only device, and Mark corrected them. The time being spent is predominantly social time. For a lot of people who use the device today, it is very much part of their lifestyle. Obviously, people are using it for screens, for media consumption, And certainly for productivity in some cases. I of course use it myself for workrooms, although I realize that that's a little bit more niche perhaps. And even things like fitness. It's a small, but it's a loyal community of people who use the headset as part of, you know, the fitness routine in their life. So I'm just saying, I'm not saying it's there yet. I certainly think the reputation is what it is for good reason. I'm just saying, I think, you know, you have to kind of examine that more closely because the shift is already afoot. Well, in the case of glasses, I think, you know, more than half of people wear glasses. I'm wearing sunglasses, even though I don't wear corrective lenses. So I'm not sure that with AR, with the vision that we have to get to a really comfortable glasses form factor feels like a pretty good path to mass market. I'm not saying it's every person, but it seems reasonable. For mixed reality, it's really about value. You know, I think people will do things that if it's enough value for them. So that's the thing we've been trying to do, is make sure these devices are not just entertaining, but also valuable. Yes, this is an important one. Thank you for the question. I love this use case too. We are planning to bring it to Quest 3, as I've said previously. It's a little bit different because the Guardian system is a little bit different. Safety still matters a lot. Mixed reality headset, we had to kind of redo the Guardian system, the Smart Guardian. We're just doing the work to make sure that we can do it reliably and safely and without having any negative impacts on the rest of the safety features. So, I like it too. We are working with good urgency here. I don't have a date for you exactly, but it is coming and we're making good progress on it. I'm so glad you asked. This has obviously been a hot topic of discussion recently. I think the answer is yes, but I do want to admit, like, openness is a pretty big spectrum and it goes really, really far out there. There are total laissez-faire systems where there's absolutely no controls. Obviously, ours isn't one of those. And if that's one of the things that you wanted, then that's disappointing. I respect that. Truly, I do. I'm a software engineer myself, and I grew up in the PC era. I think open, like, you know, how we grew up open with Windows or Linux, that's a version of open. And I'm not saying we're that. But on our platform, you can sideload. You can bring any app you want. You can do it. You can plug it into as a peripheral to another device and do whatever you want to do with it as a device. You can not just use the App Store, but also App Lab. So you can see apps with a lot fewer restrictions on them. So on the spectrum of openness, yeah, I think we're open. We're not the most open possible, but we're open. And there's more forms of openness that we're interested in too, like working with third party. I also love the open periphery design of Quest Pro. And I don't have anything to announce, but I will tell you, it's probably good for you that I also love it, since I run the team. That's all I'll say. Yeah, I love this. And I think one thing that is not well understood about our avatars is that they're very popular on other surfaces. They're not just popular inside of headsets. You know, people use them for stickers and Instagram. And absolutely a really fun idea is using them to animate video calls based on, you know, a very real view of your face. So yeah, I think avatars have huge upside. It's not just for immersive spaces. Poor crying face emoji, cheer up. As you might imagine, I have spent more time tuning various versions of mixed reality than the average person has. I respect that not everyone is going to react the same to different tunings. It is to some degree subjective, but there is some perceptual science here as well. In Apple Vision Pro, when I'm sitting at rest with my head not moving at all, certainly the image is very crisp, if a bit dim for my tastes. However, when I move my head, I get a degree of motion blur that I find very uncomfortable. On the flip side, with Quest 3, sitting in the same room at rest, the image I see is a little noisier, and like a little less crisp, certainly, just from a display artifact standpoint. But when I move my head, it doesn't get worse. It actually has a very consistent quality. There's other things Apple Vision Pro did very well too, how they managed warping and deformation from near field objects. I'm not taking anything away from that. But yes, I legitimately, personally, think Quest 3 has better pass-through than AVP does. I've been on record for this. I think that lightness is an important feature of a headset. A really valuable feature. And it trades off against things like materials and architecture and design. But I really think that's important. For me, at least, the weight, and some of this is personal. Again, people have their different opinions. Y'all, it's okay. It's cool. The weight is really bad for for some of these competitive headsets, you know, and the weight distribution, where the weight is, really heavy things far off of your nose create a long lever arm. So yeah, so for me at least, I think ergonomics is super important. I don't think we've nailed it, by the way. I'm not here being like, ah, we've done it. No, I just think, I think Quest 3 is the best out there right now. I actually still love my Quest Pro, open periphery, I mentioned that earlier. But you know, I think it's gonna be a competitive space for years to come. Click, 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 click